We have Chandra Bhushan, who is the Deputy Director for Center for Science and Environment. We have Anil Premaratne, who is the Director General, Coast Conservation Department of Sri Lanka. We have with us Mr. Mohammad Tahir Qureshi, Senior Advisor of IUCN from Pakistan. And of course, you have a familiar face sitting here, Orofilio. And so I extend a warm welcome to all of you.
First of all, thank you very much for coming. It's really wonderful to be in Pondicherry, as always. And let me give you a sense of why we did the workshop and then ask Chandra Bhushan to take you through some of the key issues that we came up with. And I will then request three panelists that I have to give us some short idea of how they visualize the challenges in their own region, their country. And then I really look forward to an open participation from all of you here in terms of what you think and what we should do. CSC in Delhi has been deeply concerned at the fact that we see environmental challenges keep growing. The scale and pace of devastation seems to be going far ahead of the efforts that we keep making to try and stop it. And one of the key things that we have identified which needs to change is the governance systems which manage natural resources in the country. When it comes to mining, when it comes to sand mining, when it comes to buildings, when it comes to mobility, or when it comes to coastal environment. And given that concern, we have in the last few months done a very extensive an intensive exercise to look at the South Asian region to see what different countries are doing in terms of the management, governance, regulatory systems that they have for coastal management. So our aim was not just to look at the state of the problem, but really look beyond it to see what are the institutions for management, what are the institutions for oversight us to see what are the solutions and push and implement the solutions. And as Chandra Bhushan will take you through the presentation, you will see what we come up with is a very common view. We come up with a view which says that we are together in the problems that we have, we share problems, but we also come out very clearly saying that we need to be able to learn from each other to share the solutions as well. To build the institutions which have the capacity to make the changes for the future that we require. And that, to us at this workshop, has been critical. It's an agenda for building, strengthening institutions of governance. It's not about just focusing on the problem. And that really was what I think has been a very interesting 2 days for us. And our effort today was that, firstly, we never get a chance to meet many of our friends in Pondicherry. So I have to confess that part of the effort was to do this public meeting was that at least we get a chance to say hello. But it's also a chance for us to share with you what we have found and to learn from you. What you see are some of the key challenges here. What is it that you feel needs to be done, and what is it that you would like us to do more on? So with that, let me get Chandra Bhushan, my colleague Chandra Bhushan, who is in a sense the organizer of this entire meeting, to take us through the issues.
Thank you, Sunita. Welcome everyone here. So after 2 days, I'm going to summarize what happened in the meeting, but let me say that these were the main issues that came out of the meeting. There were many more points, many more issues, but the main ones were these. Let me, Filio, you will have to help me. Yeah, I have to keep clipping this, okay. Now, we were here to discuss 11,240 kilometers of coastline of South Asia, supporting close to 400 million people, $15 billion worth of tourism, about 5 million tons of fish production. This is what coast of South Asia looks like. More than 100 minor and major ports, many, many thermal power plants, many mega cities. This is what the coast of South Asia we were discussing for 2 days. The meeting, we had about 70 participants from 5 South Asian countries with coasts, India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Maldives, and Pakistan. And we came together to discuss coastal management issues. We had representatives from the government, NGOs, researchers, as well as media. And we discussed issues related to regulating and managing coastal areas, protecting habitats and livelihood of vulnerable communities, as well as climate change. These were the broad areas we discussed in the meeting. The key questions, there were 5 key questions that we tried to answer in this meeting. First, how do we better regulate? Sorry. Should be, you'll have to. Will you?
What I'll do is then just go. I think, does this work? Yeah, it works. This,
okay.
You can use these.
Okay, sorry. The 5 key questions we had put out in the beginning of the meeting was, how do we better regulate coastal development, including how do we define coastal areas, how do we demarcate coastal area, how do we map coastal area, how do we regulate coastal area with environmental impact assessment that all these countries do. How do we ensure that the livelihoods dependent on the coast are enhanced and not compromised? That was the second question we tried to answer. We wanted to look at best practices in all the countries. How do we protect critical ecosystems and habitats? How do we integrate and manage coast climate change in coastal development? That was the number 4 question. And the last one was, what can we learn from each other? And what systems we put in place so that we have a continuous learning process within the region. Now, let me give you an overview of what came out of the meeting. As Sunita said, there are common challenges. There is pressure growing on the coasts of all the countries because of growing population, greater industrialization, urbanization, and tourism. These are the pressures on our coasts. And we see destruction, and we will see more destruction of habitat and livelihoods, and people living on the margins are going to be the worst affected. And that is going to happen across South Asia. And on top of all these developmental challenges that South Asia faces, we also have climate change. And therefore, South Asia, which is highly vulnerable to climate change, is going to be affected much more because of developmental challenges on one hand, as well as climate change. And therefore, we have to come together, share best practices, and there are best practices, approaches of regulations, and some countries are doing better on regulation than others, and learn from each other. That's what the overall was what was the overview of the meeting. Let me come to the outcome. What did we come in the end? What did we decide? Were the recommendations of the meeting? The major issue was regulatory challenges, and South Asia faces regulatory challenges. Each country has its own system of defining, demarcating, and regulating activities in coastal areas, each with strengths and weaknesses. Some are doing better than others, but there are weaknesses in each of them. What came out quite clearly was that each country needs strengthening of regulatory system, both in terms of decision making, how we make decisions, and how we enforce those decisions. For example, quality of EIA report, based on which most of the developmental decisions are taken, is not up to the mark in all the countries. And how do we improve that quality of environmental impact assessment report is very, very important. What also became quite clear in the meeting is that the post-clearance monitoring and enforcement is weak. So we give clearances, but the institutions to monitor and enforce post-clearance is weak in most of the countries. That needs strengthening. There were issues of limitations of doing individual EIA report. Right now, in all these countries, EIA is done for individual project and clearances are given. But as I showed on the first slide, development is happening, there are ports coming, thermal power plants are coming, tourism resorts are coming, cities are coming up, there are cumulative impact. How do we capture cumulative impact? That issue also came up. But what is most important is not the term cumulative impact, But how do we develop a robust methodology to do cumulative impact? Recently, National Green Tribunal gave a judgment saying do cumulative impact for a project just 20 kilometers from here, from Puducherry. And it is, and the project proponent did something called as rapid cumulative impact. That's what they did. We don't need those kind of cumulative impact assessment for decision making. We need robust methodology for cumulative impact assessment. The other regulatory challenges which is there in South Asia is that coasts are dynamic, and you need a regulatory system which can respond to this dynamic nature of coast, which means that you need to have quick and informed regulatory system, quick and informed decision-making system, and it can only happen if the decision-making is not in Delhi, but local, is not centralized, but decentralized. So the decision-making became, how do we take quick decision and informed decision and locally is key for managing our coasts. And this means that the involvement of local community in decision making, which is actually in legislation across South Asia, must be practiced. It shouldn't remain a policy document. Another point was, regulation is just one tool. We all focus too much on just regulation, command and control regulatory regime that all of us have. But it is just one tool. There are many more tools to improve coastal management, which includes tools like putting information in public domain, putting maps of coastal areas in public domain, training, education, involvement of local community. They all have to be put together to develop a holistic, governance system. Right now, maybe we are putting too much focus just on regulation, which at least in case of India is not working. It's working in some way in some countries, but we need to have a package of tools to manage coastal areas. Climate change is a threat that we all are going to see and hear about in the coming years. Sea level in coast South Asia is rising at about 3.2 millimeter every year, which has doubled than the past 10 years. We are now facing extreme weather events. Cyclones are becoming much more, the intensity of cyclones are increasing. Some countries have started to put in place systems to adapt to climate change. And Maldives and Bangladesh, it came out quite clearly that they have started thinking about climate change adaptation. But countries like India, Sri Lanka, and Pakistan, we need to do more as far as climate change adaptation is concerned. But the most important thing is that all of us in South Asia, we will have to put system in place that will make sure that the coastal development takes into account climate change. Right now, no EIA, no SIA, no cumulative impact assessment even takes into account the future impact of climate change. So we need to develop systems which will include climate change in coastal development, or for that matter, in general, our developmental plan and practices. Integrated coastal zone management. This is the word all of us have heard for years and years. But the issue is it has remained more or less a word. The practice is very, very poor. The fact is coast in each country is limited and we have competing demand. The first thing we need to learn is how do we do more with less? Do we need to give, as the Chief Secretary said in the inaugural session, 400 acres to set up a 500 megawatt thermal power plant? Or can we do it in 50 acres? Do we need to build more ports, or can we enhance the capacity of existing ports? Now these are the questions that we need to answer. So we need to do more with less. Secondly, we need to practice integrated coastal management. And lastly, it needs to be institutionalized. Coastal, integrated coastal management needs to be institutionalized. We also looked at the issue of livelihoods and habitats, and it became quite clearly from Baluchistan in Pakistan to Khulna in Bangladesh to areas of India, habitat destruction is evident across South Asia. We are destroying mangroves and corals. We are destroying critical ecosystems. But the restoration effort is not sufficient. So we are destroying far more than what we are restoring. Therefore, upscaling becomes very, very important. And secondly, how do we involve local community in this upscaling effort? The most important thing is there are success stories. There are success stories of involvement of local community, of co-management, of benefit sharing that needs to be practiced and upscaled. Let me come to the last slide. And the key issue here is we need to learn from the past. The future planning must be done with learning from the past. None of us have system which is actually learning from the past. So we need system to assess impact of past projects so that we can design future projects better. And in that context, research becomes very important. And research across South Asia on coastal issues is poor to say the least. And that needs to be strengthened. Thank you very much.
Thank you, CB. And as you see, that really became the base, that is the basis in which we will be moving ahead. Set ourselves an agenda, clearly identified where are the gaps, the weaknesses, and we as institutions will see how can we get these implemented through our government policies. But we are very privileged to have with us a very senior and a very experienced officer from, official from Sri Lanka, Mr. Anil Premaratne, who's the Director General of Coast Conservation Department of Sri Lanka, and has actually worked in coastal management for the past over 30 years. And over the last 2 years, we have been very enriched to learn of some very interesting work that is happening in Sri Lanka and the lead that they are taking to look at conservation, development, and together. And this is a country which has set itself very big goals for increase in tourism, increase in development, but also has the challenge of managing a very rich biodiversity today, and also has recognized the need for community control. So let me ask Mr. Premaratne to give us his idea of how we move ahead. Thank you.
Good evening, and thank you very much for giving me a chance to actually give some few words regarding my experiences as a person and the experiences as a Sri Lanka, which we have received during the last, we have implemented our coastal management plan since 1980. We have the 30, 40 years experiences. So we are talking here two major things. One is that the resources we are talking here is the common resources belong to everybody. Our common future report very clearly states that the common resources everybody own, nobody care. Because this common resources ownership, if we ask, it is on everybody. If we talk coral belong to everybody because it is common resources. If you call beach, it belong to everybody. But if you ask who is going to look after, all the communities say that it is the government. Government has to protect, they have to use. Then the issue comes in. Up to what level they can use? No, they say it is our resources, we can use whatever. The government say, no, you can't use that. That is the conflict started with. So now we are trying to bridge this gap. The government say, no, you can't. The common community say, no, it is our resources, we need to use. So now we are talking to bridge this gap. The government and the community come to some kind of agreement, how much you can use, how much we have to regulate. So that the basic principle we are talking here for 2 days, how to change the behavior of the people. It's people included the government officials, people included the resource users, so that behavior changes is not a very simple thing to do. I have been travel and studies and work 57 countries right across the world. I work in many countries, and almost all the countries I got the experiences that the common resources management is challengeable. Everybody complaining each other. So that what we can do, so that my 34 years experiences in coastal resource management in Sri Lanka is proved to me that unless you step down, you can't go to the community. Community also has to think that government official, even though they are official, they are human being, they have to face several dilemmas. I was assaulted several times by politicians in the hospital because of coastal resources management. But the soul, if you gave it up, you can't win. So the one thing is that the government officers has to bear all the problems and go ahead, because the determination is very important for the government official. At the same time, the community also think that they have to think that these resources belong to us, therefore we also have some responsibility without pointing the finger to the government official. You have to look after our resources we are using. That is the thing we have to change. So the other important point I want to make that resource management cannot be done with the one single strategies, because we talk a lot of the regulations. Regulation is one approach, but my experiences is regulations are very, very bitter thing to the community. So laws, regulation, they are paid up, give up. And regulation simply they ignore. I will give you the one classic example in Sri Lanka. We try to control of coral mining. The coral mining in 1980s, coral for the lime industry was thriving in this time, because my first salary in the Sri Lanka in 1980, the 650 Sri Lankan rupees. Whereas coral miner per day earn 1,000 rupees. That is I have a bachelor's degree and per month I am getting 650 rupees, whereas coral miner earn 1,000 rupees per day. So if we ask him to come and get the alternative jobs, what we can offer them? The government senior, government officer getting 650, they are just 5-6 years education. Only we can offer the labor job, where you can earn the 450. Who is coming for the 450 per month? They are earning 1,000. Therefore, we try to regulate, we imposed, and we implemented our cost constraint. Cost constraint access completely banned the coral mining. But the people mine. So one day we went with the police, because we don't have the police power. We asked police to support us to apprehend these coral miners. I took three people, apprehended and bring into the police jeep, and went to catch more people. When I come in, we have heap of people in the jeep. Then I ask, only we three kept apprehended, why you are in the jeep? So you are taking us to the police, then we don't have money, they will put us in jail, they will give us the food and everything and shelter, because they are in the jail, the government is providing free of meal and the shelter, because we are prepared to go there. So what for the regulations? Regulations, nothing for the poor people. They are prepared to go to jail rather than staying mining, because mining, coral mining is not an easy job. They are not wearing this anything. And jump into the coral and mining, they are almost dead because of this seawater. Their hair is gray because of seawater. Life is terrible, but still doing because the livelihood first. Therefore, we realize that the regulations are not applicable alone. Therefore, the other approach also required, which is the awareness and education. People must know what are the importance of the coral, what are the habitat, how fish are depend on the corals. Then they realize and they gave it up. So otherwise, rules and regulations are immaterial. It's a paperwork. Laws are a paper. Nothing to do with the human, because they are, first thing is they are start today meal and not the future. So therefore, my second experiences is not relevant to at least developing countries, the single approach. You have to have education, you need the research, you have to have some kind of other approaches, monitoring and evaluation, your programs, because many cases people need some tangible benefits. What we are doing is to prepare that we are doing the surveys. People doesn't need them. they feel that these idiot people are coming and doing something and preparing report and keeping the shells. What for? They need some tangible benefits to see that. So any project without doing any tangible benefits to see people, all other things, they are simply refuse. Go. You are always doing the reports. nothing happening. So therefore, Sri Lanka, we implement the two-track approach. While you are doing something, research and everything, we also do something to see them, the tangible benefits. Then they are coming for us to work together. That's why we change the behavior of the community, and we took to our side many people, and now we don't want to go away because we are in Colombo and the things are happening Hambantota 50-60 kilometers away. We cannot control. Now people are control, and people are complaining, and people are not allowing to do any mining, or people are not allowing to cut the mango. They are complaining us, they are giving up us out. Now we are giving support to replanting, rehabilitation of resources, not like a project doing it, or the project people, the people doing, we are giving the technically rhizophora not suitable this area, we are telling that you plant any other species. This is not the way to do it, and something like that. Therefore, we have to, you have to, government agency has to facilitate role rather than the dictator role or the officer role. That is another experiences we receive. Now we are always facilitating rather than implementing. Implementing part taken by the resource users. It took for us to nearly 23 years to change this behavior. Overnight you can't do it. So many people are thinking that tomorrow. So my experiences are like that. The government officers can't change, and they cannot go back. They have to go, they have to step down, and they have to work with the community. They have to learn, because traditional knowledge is very important to know the things, how they are doing. So we have to study from them, they have to study from us. That's what the reason behind for success certain stories. Still we are far behind, because certain areas still we want to know. And as a region, certain cases, community alone cannot implement certain areas where regional support really required. That's why Chris and other Bob Lemay, whatever projects this area has to look after, external impacts to the communities. So that external impact can be political, can be socioeconomic, can be climate, all those things has to be looked after central government. The resource management pass has to be given to the community with the integrated manner. Thank you so much.
I should also tell you that you have broken 650 illegal buildings in this last few years in Sri Lanka, last year alone. So I think that's really what good enforcement is about, and that's what we need to see a lot more of. Mr. Tahir Qureshi is from Pakistan, from IUCN Pakistan, and he is known as the father of mangroves in Pakistan. And I think for this region, which is so desperate to see how we can protect, regenerate our mangroves, I think we need to find a way where we can call you the father of mangroves in South Asia. So please tell us more about your work over there.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I will start my presentation making a very strong statement, since she has challenged me. Far from being the wasteland that they used to be considered, mangroves are highly productive and useful areas of tropics and subtropics. You have also mangroves, we have also mangroves. They perform multiple functions, people, they don't know about it, such as production of woody plants, food, spawning ground, habitat for marine and terrestrial animal, protection of shoreline from erosion, and protection from cyclone, hurricane, tsunami. The mangrove ecosystem is dynamic and fragile, but it has great ability to restore itself. The ecosystem is complex and difficult when it is compared with the terrestrial ecosystem. Unfortunately, all over the Asian, Southeast Asian countries, mangroves are vanishing. The resource is depleting at an alarming rate due to natural and human-induced stresses. The common threats to the mangroves areas, to the coastal areas, is from the scarcity of fresh water, at least in my country. Because water is a physiological requirement of all plants and all animals, including human beings as well. Those mangroves, they always generate from the fresh water, but they have great ability to adopt themselves in the saline conditions. In our case, we had 8 species, timber-producing species. They all disappeared except Avicennia marina, which is a dominant species, colonizer. It is a colonizer and a pioneering species and very hardy. So therefore, what is required, you see, just to combat the scarcity of fresh water, what we did, people said that, what are you doing? You want to throw money into the sea? The aridity is 200 millimeter rainfall, even less than that, and which is erratic, unevenly distributed. There is a dry spells of 3 years to 7 years. So they said that they will not survive. But we selected those species which were best suited to our existing conditions, to the saline and arid conditions, and we started raising mangroves. Similarly, this is the one threat which we started to combat. There was the pollution, all kinds of pollution coming from the urban limits of Karachi, from the agricultural lands, from the industries, you see. And we started putting mangroves in the, along the coast, because they have purifying role also. They almost in Chantaburi forest near Bangkok, they have conducted an experiment. 25% of solid waste which comes with the effluents is tapped into the roots of the mangroves, and then it forms, it is used in the soil compositions. So therefore, we started putting the mangroves plantations just to combat all the pollution. Similarly, we have the oil pollution from the ships, from the oil refinery, and there is a lack of management. There is no scientific management. The world has gone to the integrated coastal zone management, but we don't have simple coastal zone management. But nevertheless, IUCN Pakistan, back in 1985, launched its rehabilitation program in collaboration with the governmental, non-governmental organization and communities. We brought all those people together and the institutions, and we started raising, we started our rehabilitation restoration program. And under that program, we thought that our goal should be, the overall goal should be the conservation and sustainable use of the natural resources of Pakistan coastal areas. And for that reason, you see, in order to attain, we wanted to attain that goal, you see, so we focused our activities on institutional strengthening and capacity building of the governmental, non-governmental, and the communities. So all those organizations as well as the community on one side, and also we started beating blank areas, those areas which were mudflats. Once upon a time there were mangroves, but now they are barren. They are becoming depleted. So therefore we started replanting those areas, and the community was with us, and they realized that this fishery potential is increasing in their creeks. So we've drawn them and we involve them with our work by formal trainings as well as by own hand training in the silviculture, and they were working with us. So in this way, the community and the government departments and IUCN, they were working side by side, and so far we have planted over 50,000 hectares of plantations all along the coast of Pakistan. We have the network of nurseries and chains of the plantations of different age gradations, and which has increased tremendously the fishery potential, especially the crustacean fisheries, which are using as a breeding grounds of our mangroves. Then we started coastal community development works with the aim of improving their environmental conditions of the villages, as well as creating awareness about threats to their natural resources. For that reason, we took several initiatives in order to supplement their income, like introduction of household aquaculture, apiculture, and solar energy efficient stoves, and ecotourism. So these were our initiatives, and with this, the people, they were involved in these, because they have the dormant season. In dormant season, they started doing the aquaculture as well as the apiculture, and in this way, they are doing. On the other side, with the academia and the national institutes, we started basic research on the different aspect of mangrove forest and fisheries of Indus Delta and along the coast of Pakistan. 37 technical reports were prepared. They were disseminated to the concerned department, to the academia, to the National Institute for its implementation, and it was the transfer of technology as well as the information dissemination. So by this, we always say that the model of management which we have developed, we are proud to say that it is not only being applied within Pakistan, even outside Pakistan, in Red Sea, as well as in Persian Gulf. So what, in the end, I would say that we had a lot of challenges. There were dacoits, there were smugglers operating in our area, and then the feudal lords, they don't want to see people working in those areas, improving the economic conditions of local, socio-economic conditions of local populations. There were great resistance, but IUCN, with in collaboration with the government, concerned government departments, as well as the communities, we made our way, and by the grace of Allah Almighty, we were successful, and this is something which I can say very proudly that it is a success story. With this, I stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Qureshi. And now let me ask Filio to give a presentation to us. You all know Filio. I don't need to introduce him to you. But I do want to say that for me, Prabir, Nini, and Filio have been my gurus as far as teaching me how a small intervention, as we saw in the Pondi harbor, can make such a major impact. And I saw this, I think, about 2 years ago, Filio?
Yes, it was.
When
2 years ago,
yes. You took me around, and it changed my perspective completely to understand what a beach was really about. And your whole idea about sea, about a beach being a river of sand, has transformed our own thinking. So thank you very much.
Well, when we started addressing the problem of coastal erosion that Pondi has been facing, which I suppose most of you are quite familiar with now after 10 years of our repeating the same story on and on and on. In fact, the story grew from Pondicherry, problem restricted to Pondicherry, to then a problem that became an interstate issue because the erosion was moving from Pondicherry into Tamil Nadu. And that became a concern, you know, the problem became larger. That led us to then study other parts of India, look at what's happening. And then we discovered that what's happening in Pondicherry is not unique to this coast, to just our little stretch of the coastline, but happens all over India. And now, with Sunita's and CSE's intervention, now this problem, in fact, has gone at a South Asian level and dimension. So it's going places, and it's nice to be part of that process. So what I will show here a little bit is the journey, a part of our journey, of, you know, the way we've been going. Now, one thing that, you know, we have understood over time is that India's coastline is a soft coastline. In fact, about 90% of the coastline is soft, is either sandy or muddy or marshy. You know, only about 10% is rocky, which means that because it is soft, it is vulnerable to change, it is fragile. Therefore, you know, any development on this coastline can alter the environment very quickly. Having recognized this, you know, then, you know, why is it soft? It's because we have large number of rivers which bring sand, you know, from the land towards the sea, and then the waves and the ocean currents distribute and spread this sand along the Indian coast, which is what is illustrated on this slide here. And you can see that on the east coast, the sand is moving from the south to the north. On the west coast, it's from the north to the south. And it's not small amounts of sand, it's large amounts of sand, like up to the tune of, you know, 500,000 to even 1,000,000 cubic meters per annum. So this is, you know, along our coastline, it's about 500,000 cubic meters of sand. And we can see, yeah, it, in fact, what Sunita just mentioned earlier, people don't realize that, you know, beaches are in fact rivers of sand. It's not just a static heap of sediment that was there yesterday, that is there today, and that will be there tomorrow. The sand is renewing itself, is being exchanged every year, every season, and the sand is moving, as we can see in that slide to the left, by the waves. The waves, in fact, can be compared to the, or can be called the engines of sand transportation, and they move this large amount of sand up and down the coast. Of course, we as human beings like interfering with nature, we like imposing ourselves, and this is what has happened in Pondi. We built a harbor along the path of this flow of sand, and because we did so, we have disturbed the natural coastal environment, and we have upset this flow of sand. Therefore, we have in fact accumulation of sand on one side of the harbor. The sand is coming from the south to the north, and on its way to the north, it, you know, hits a roadblock, the harbor mouth, and it gets stuck there. And sand on the other side keeps flowing northwards, but there is no renewal of sand. There is no nourishment and replenishment of that sediment that is being taken away by the waves and the ocean currents to the north, and therefore we have a process of erosion, which, like a cancer, has been spreading northwards. So these are the consequences of the erosion. You know, we had a 150 meter wide beach in Pondi, which disappeared over the years, and we have zero beach today. This is in front of the town, just to get some nostalgia, how the town used to be 20 years ago. And of course, as we move north towards Tamil Nadu, the fishing communities, the fishing hamlets have been losing homes, and the coastal environment is being destructed. In fact, our friends in Auroville now are facing the brunt of coastal erosion. It has reached up to the coastlines of Auroville, and last monsoon they have lost a few homes. They are the victims now of this problem of erosion. As a result of that, in the last 20 years, this coastline, the Pondi Tamil Nadu coastline, has lost over 10 kilometers of beaches. You can see on the right-hand side of the image on top, the big amount of sand that is stuck, you know, the big beaches that are artificially being formed to the south of the town, but to the north, you don't see a speck of sand. And it's not only the loss of a nice little beach, you know, on which we can have fun, but beaches have functions, they provide services, you know, to communities. They act like natural barriers. They protect the groundwater, so we have also big, when we lose beaches, we have saltwater intrusion and so forth. So it's impacting us in many ways. And the ones who are most directly affected are the local communities that live directly on the beach and that need the beach for their livelihoods. When we try to fix this problem of erosion without really understanding the larger picture, you know, and I mentioned the larger picture because we will then, you know, see where we are leading to what's coming in front of us in the future. Then just trying to fix a little bit of erosion with a few stones to try and save a few homes may help that particular place, but does it really solve the problem? Does it help the larger coastal environment? And it has been found that this is not the case, because we are just, you know, passing the buck on to the next beach. And this is illustrated here. Where the seawall ends, the erosion continues. And in fact, it doesn't only continue, but it gets aggravated and exacerbated. So we have here, in fact, the last groin that has been built now, which is designed to retain sand. But of course, when you try to retain sand, you are depleting another beach from that sand. And therefore, you can see the erosion that has been caused, and in a way you can see the bleeding coastline with the red soil that's leaching into the water as we go towards Auroville. And is this really productive, or is it counterproductive? We did a quick study, and we found that by trying to artificially manage your coastline, you know, you gain about a square meter of beach when you build these groins, but then you're losing four. So the larger coastal environment is being impacted to a greater extent. You're not solving a problem. You're, in fact, creating a larger problem. Let me just skip this. I think I can skip these. And so coastal erosion is one of the problems we are facing. And, you know, we have all these impacts on the coastal environment, you know, be it power plants, harbors, commercial developments, coastal structures, sand mining, and of course the construction of dams that, you know, block the movement of sand and don't allow sand from the rivers to reach the sea. And at the national level, you know, about 25% of the coastline is eroding presently because of poor management of the coastline. So it's, you know, India's coastline is already facing the consequences of bad planning, bad coastal management. And why is that happening? And, you know, this is what led us to try and look at the national perspective and to get an overview of what's happening along the Indian coast. So with the help of a few partners like the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, TIS, BNHS, and our partners who belong to an organization called NCPC, a larger network of NGOs, we conducted a nationwide study to try and understand, you know, what's happening along India's coastline. And what we found is that we, you know, with the help of satellite imagery in Google Earth, we counted each and every settlement along the coastline just to understand how busy is India's coastline? How much of it is occupied? How much of it is free? How much of the natural habitat is lost, or how much of the natural habitat is still available, you know, still kind of virgin? And we found that in terms of settlements, we have about 1,300 settlements occupying already 1,400 kilometers of the coastline, or about 21% of the coastline is already occupied by human settlements. Then we have ports. We have 143 ports along the entire coast of India that occupy about 100 kilometers. But ports, as we have seen in the case of Pondi, a single port has an impact zone of about 10 kilometer radius. So every port, in fact, we can imagine occupies, in fact, an area of about 20 kilometers on each side. So if you say that every port has an impact radius of 10 kilometers, we have a structure about every 10 kilometers of the coast. So, you know, we have structures added to that. Then you have power plants, coastal power plants. There are 27 of them right now. Another 59 are proposed. And in the middle of all this, there is still some space for the natural habitat. In fact, about 9% is still water bodies in terms of lagoons and estuaries and river mouths. And when you add all this up, you know, this is what you get. You get the challenge coast of India, where you know you have already so much happening and so little left that is free. So how are we going to manage what's left is essentially the challenge. And this is what I think is a challenge that is common not only to us, but also to the entire South Asian region. We have already used up a lot of our coastal environment. We have damaged it. And how are we going to manage what's left? And if possible, we need to, and I'm sure, I mean, that is the way ahead, we need to restore what has been lost so that we regain a little bit. And this effort of ours has been essentially to provide information on a public information network so that people can be empowered through information sharing. So all this information is online. Coastal communities can upload this information on the net. And it's not only, let's say, developers, those who build ports or those who build power plants or those who build structures on the coast who know what's happening, but all coastal communities can have access to this information and then make informed decisions. Thank you. I think that's it.
Thank you. I hope that gives you a flavor of what we were doing in the last 2 days and our concerns and obviously also our excitement, because I think what we do find is that it isn't as if nothing is happening. Things are happening across the region, across South Asia. Governments are getting more aware. There is a challenge. The question really for all of us is, how do we upscale the pace of our interventions? How do we actually make sure we can make the difference at the scale that is needed? And that really is an open question still. In our view at CSC, the key intervention point is to strengthen institutions, is to find ways to make institutions more accountable, more transparent, get them to deliver what they're supposed to do. But I think there are many other issues, and that's what I want to open up now to all of you here, and to hear from you, your perspectives, and any questions you may have, but also your perspectives on what you see as the issues. Can I invite? We have mics, Prabir. I don't have hands, I have mics right now. No issues? Yes, Prabir, maybe get us started and then.
Yeah, I have a technical question. I was born in a country which is about 1/3 below sea level, Netherlands. And even that country, although you would expect them to be much more aware of these issues, made the mistake of doing human interventions. And it was exactly the same thing as happening in Pondicherry, the beach at some stretch between Rotterdam and I think The Hague started eroding. And what I read a couple of months back, what they did was they actually dredged sand and they took it over this block and left it there and then allowed nature to again spread it out all over the coast. Is that something that the experts here think is advisable and doable as an immediate intervention?
Yeah. We are facing similar because the country required a lot of fisheries facilities. We call the fisheries harbors. When you build a fishery harbor, a straight beach, this is phenomena impacts because a straight line and the little drift go in one direction, you block and put in shelter. Therefore, it is very common that one area you get accumulation, other area erosion. So we tried out several options because the fishermen also need the facilities. At the same time, we have to maintain the beach process. So that what we did was we normally when we given the permit, we gave the fishery harbor each year you have to, because you have to do a lot of calculations, how much sand you trap per year. So that amount you have to pump to the other sides. That right from beginning you have to do. But here mistake done by the agency. I'm not telling the mistake, whatever, because they have not the proper maintenance program has not been introduced. So that what has happened was once after the construction of this Amarok or whatever, the breakwater, they thought that it is answer to the, that's what we call the sectoral approach, because they provided the fishery harbor but not considered the beach process. So now accumulating one side, so it is one answer but still not the proper answer, because if it is as mentioned that if the river system bringing sand to the system, then it is further easy because sand is bringing by the sea. Here case, no river nearby. So there is a deficit. This is like a budget. We call the sand budget. Always you have to calculate the sand budget and see that the deficit. And you have to fill like a budget. So here not has happened both. There's no river nearby, no sand pump into the other side. So both created, aggravated, accelerated impact to the northern. So either now they have to pump sand artificially from the offshore, or they have to pump this sand, because once it is accumulated, people are not allowing you to pump those sand because they think that this is our beach, now you are going to try to put. So that is the major problem you have to pay. Right from beginning, people can't see that there's a beach formation. Therefore, once it form a beach, people are not allowing. So now it's a permanent solution is to pump artificial from the offshore and redesign the structure. Thank you.
Yes, if I may just supplement to that and probably just add a few points, just go back a few slides. Let's say to begin with, the school of thinking, in fact, has changed. Until recently, the school of thinking was, you know, fight against nature, therefore, you know, hard solution, dikes, seawalls, groins. And the thinking has changed now, and the thinking is, in fact, you know, let's work together with nature. So if there was a sandy beach, you know, you don't try to transform it into a rocky coast, but then you try to find sediment to supplement the missing sand. And of course, you need to understand why the sand is missing. In the case of Pondi, if I just go back a few slides, and just to put it into the local context. Sorry. Yeah, so you know, this sand that's lying here is sand that belongs, in fact, to the Auroville beaches. And so it's not lost, it's there. It's a little bit like a bank deposit, you know. And it is, in fact, a resource. It is a valuable resource which can be, you know, shifted from this side to the other. Interestingly, when the harbor was designed, it was designed to do that. They had designed the harbor to continually bypass the sand, but it was not done. It was not done for many reasons. And this is what, in fact, we are pushing. We are trying to get the government to, you know, take this sand and push it away. Maybe people will object as you warn us. Then they'll have to look for other supplementary sources of sand or maybe go offshore. But for sure, this is, let's say, very much conceivable. And this is what we are working towards.
But buying headache means that when the monsoon is other direction, it's sand coming and block the river mouth also. This is both the function cannot be done because they are expecting the fishery harbor during the off monsoon, sand coming, the direction is other way. So that those sand also cannot take down to the beach. Therefore, one way is blocked during the monsoon, other way blocked during the off monsoon, because that's why you could see that the lagoon mouth also blocked by sand because the drift is coming back toward the other way. So they continuously dredge, you have to dredge both sides, and it's enormous money you are spending.
But you know, when we were discussing this, I was telling, and I want to repeat that here, the analogy for me with the harbor, the groins that are being made, is traffic in Delhi. And it's a weird analogy, but I think as I explain it, you will understand. When you look at traffic, all the solutions that people propose are flyovers and extending roads. And that's what we are fighting in Delhi. And for the last 5-6 years, we've been constantly arguing that you can build all the flyovers, but cars will fill them up, and you will have to keep building more flyovers, and the cars will fill them up more. And the real problem is to reinvent mobility. And you need to rethink about how you can move people in buses, bicycles, make them walk. And if you don't have the right to walk and you don't have the right to bicycle, then there is no way that your flyovers are going to be the answer.